Welcome, welcome, welcome. I think we'll get started. Imagine our organizers are on time, right?
No, we were early.
Actually, we were half hour early. And then we were debating about how to set up the table. Boy, they just get right in there because they're gifted, right? Well, welcome. My name is Cyndi Cummings, and I'm the founder of the Austin Senior Resource Alliance. And you'll see our banner over here. We're a group of businesses who come together to help seniors and their families through the process of aging. And we have several different businesses that are part of our group. And what we do is we go around and we do seminars, and we have different topics. And so our topic today is on decluttering, which everybody needs help with that, right? So we're so excited about that. In addition, next month we're going to have a class on directives. And directives are just getting your paperwork in place for that time in which you pass to help your family off, basically. So that's our workshop next month. The next month, our workshop's going to be on fraud. And we have some really exciting people.
Fraud.
Yeah, so a homeowner scams. We're going to talk about homeowner scams, things to look out for. I almost bought a pickup on Facebook last night for $1,000. It was such a great price. I was like, and it was a friend who was selling it for his sister. And then the sister asked me to give her information to do the transaction that sounded a little funny. So I texted my friend, whose sister it was, and they said, it's a scam. Mm-hmm. They had logged into their Facebook page and posted this pickup being sold. Yeah. So, you know, even me, you know, and I'm on Facebook and doing technology all the time, there's lots of fraud out there. So excited about that one too. So welcome, welcome. We'll go ahead and get started here. And I was going to read your bio, but I think we'll let them tell you about each of themselves. So we'll go ahead and begin if you would.
Start with you.
Baby. I'll start. Hi.
Carol, look at them. They're organizing each other. Okay. I'm in charge. Carol, start.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. This is going to be a really great, informative, and fun session. I'm Carol Jones. My company is a Jones for Organizing, and I specialize in residential home organizing. Some of my colleagues do businesses, but I just do homes, closets, kitchens, garages, things like that. I'm a NAPO member of the National Association of Productivity and Organizing Professionals.
Productivity,
yeah, yeah.
And I've been a member of NAPO for 8 years now.
Great, super, that's great.
Hi, I'm Christina Potter. I am a retired professional organizer. I started my business in 1993, working in Austin. That was before people even knew what a professional organizer was. And so you have to explain every time, well, this is what we do. So I have enjoyed my career. I started also the local organization here, which now is a chapter of NAPO. And I think the thing about doing my business, I loved helping people. And it was all, put their mind at ease, you know, it's all going to be easy. We know how to do it. Just let us help you. Christina Potter.
Hi, my name is Randy Lyman, and my business is A Helping Hand. And I am a certified professional organizer, and I specialize in working with people with chronic disorganization. I'm also a member of NAPO, and the three of us are NAPO Austin, and we're also of course, NAPO National. And so I've been organizing for 17 years. I offer residential, and I also offer virtual, so I can virtually organize people all over the world.
Wow, I like to see that.
Call me up, we'll do it.
And I should have introduced myself. I'm Cyndi Cummings. I'm with Keller Williams. I have a move management portion to my business, and the move manager helps people when they're making the move, doing some things like they do, but not as complex. So, and my move management company is called Turnkey Transitions. Okay, so let's go on. Carol, if you would. Let's assume that someone is really excited about starting the decluttering process and they want to do it on their own. What are some of the areas they may start with?
Well, I don't know that I would say start with the kitchen or start with a closet or start with a garage. I would say if you wanted to try to do it by yourself, start small, because it can be really overwhelming if you say to yourself, I'm going to clean out my entire closet today. You're going to get tired and overwhelmed. So start small. Start with, you know, sometimes just a drawer, really, and set a timer. And that way you can go do something different at the end of that time, or you keep going. But if you start small, it gives you a sense of accomplishment, and you can see the progress you're making, and it helps you to motivate you to keep going.
The one thing I say is most people underestimate the amount of time it will take. So same thing about starting small. But the other thing I told people is that what is the one place in your house that would make you the happiest? If I could get that one area taken care of, I would be so thrilled. And just focus on that one thing. And again, we're talking about breaking it down into small areas. Again, do a timer, do some way that you know that this is all I'm going to devote to this. I'm going to go away, do something else, and then come back to it later. So again, that was the thing. You can pick, you know, living room, bedroom, kitchen, whatever, but realize that those areas are usually large and you're going to have a lot of things in there.
Yeah, so tail ending on that. And so my work is, I'm working with people that are at the beginning of a spectrum and could be all the way to hoarding disorders. So, you know, when my clients, when they're thinking about a place, I'll say, you know what, sit in that spot, sit in different places. If it's driving you crazy, sit and let it talk to you. If you don't know, right? If you have no idea where you're going to start. And like Carol said, you know, and Christina said, when you're doing small spaces and you're accomplishing whatever it is you're going to accomplish, and be realistic about time and task, right? Because if you're not realistic, you're going to really lose motivation, and you're going to just walk away from it and just really, you know, say, oh, you know, I couldn't do this. So really be realistic about it and just, you know, think about what I'm going to do and also what needs to be done, right? So how much do I need to do? And again, just like they said, start small, work up, and there you go.
All right. Okay, so Carol, based on your experience, what are some of the challenges or obstacles people face when trying to declutter?
So do I get to go first on everyone?
Well, these organizers, they are not shy.
I can go first.
Okay.
Because this is a great Randy.
Is it? Okay.
Yes. Okay. Okay, all right, great Randy question. So first of all, when clients call me, they don't know where to begin, right? So where do I begin? So that can mean that they're frozen in fear, you know, anxiety. So having, you know, being really anxious about what they need to do, frozen in indecision. So that is one of the things that really can stop somebody from the decluttering process. You know, and so some of the physical, you know, some of the obstacles are just that I don't know what to do, you know? And sometimes I don't know what to do for decades, you know? And once it gets to decades, even if it gets to a couple of years, that's a huge obstacle. And sometimes it's such a huge obstacle, it's a mountain. Literally, it's a mountain. And so at that point, it, you know, it can really become a huge problem. Okay, so Christina, since Carol's such a baby. Oh.
They've known each other for a long time.
A real long time. Yeah. A real long time.
I think one of the obstacles I've seen is that trying to do too much, and this goes back to our earlier question, yeah, is you think, I'm going to do the whole house instead of taking a small area. So that's one of the ones that stops people. And then also that they have to be super organized. I'm so embarrassed with all of my stuff, and I have to be perfect, and all of those things, that stops you right there. So some of the times it's just rethinking the whole process. And it's that there's so many, okay, with all of us here, we would have three or four different ways to approach something. There is no one right way to do it and all that. So sometimes it's in our brain, the obstacle is the first step. So just say, okay, I'm just going to try this today. No one's going to judge me. I'm going to just see what happens. And again, of course, there's so many places to find information if you want to learn how to do more about organizing. But that was one of the big obstacles, and also people get bored with the process. Mm-hmm. They'll do a little bit, and it's like, oh, I'm so tired of doing this. It's so boring. I have to give up. So that's one of the things that you've got to figure out. So when we were talking about, you know, deciding what you're going to do, you've got to decide, okay, what am I going to do? What's my limit? How long can I go? An hour? Can I go 30 minutes? Okay, what's my reward after that? If I can go and do something fun. So again, those are some of the obstacles we, you know, run into.
Although we do consider it fun. But So to answer to this question, what are some of the challenges or obstacles people face? The ones that I wrote down are being overwhelmed and guilt at sometimes at, well, you know, my Aunt Matilda gave me this monstrously ugly statue, and I love my Aunt Matilda, so I can't get rid of it. And there's a guilt thing that people have, especially with family members and stuff. So that's one obstacle that, you know, getting rid of it does not mean that you don't love Aunt Matilda. And perfection, I think y'all both talked about that. It doesn't have to be perfect. In the world of Pinterest and Instagram and house.com, if you know all those home decor magazines and things like that, your house doesn't have to look perfect to be functional and be organized and work for you. If it's pretty too, that's great too, but that's not really, you don't have to work toward perfection before you can even start.
You know, and let me just piggyback on that. Again, it's like what I said. Now, perfection's fear and perfection's anxiety. And I love to say, and I think I'm going to have this on my my grave, is going to be, I'm perfect in my imperfections, because, you know, that is all the time what I also, you know, what we also deal with our clients, what their challenges are, is that, again, that being frozen. So there you go.
I thought maybe you were going to say one of the obstacles is family. You know, other family
oh,
members.
Oh, no, that's a huge.
Is it? Okay. I asked a question out of order. Okay. Let's see. What are some of the long-term physical benefits to decluttering? Christina?
Well, on my list here of things, it's first of all, it's easier to clean. You have less things to move around. Actually, you have more money. It's amazing. When you get rid of all of the clutter and stuff, there's less expense paid to storing all of those things. So that's the thing. It's a time saver. You're not having, first of all, a time saver, I guess, in your daily routine, but also even in your mind, because those things are interrupting your thoughts. And so it, once that's out of the way, that's a great thing. And also, another one I had is that you can find important papers in an emergency. If you really have, you know, with all the floods we had this year and things like that, so many people said if you had your stuff, you could just grab it, go out the door, grab the most important things. All of those things are the physical things, benefits of decluttering.
So also physical, we need to think about health and well-being. So if one has physical disabilities or mental health challenges, can they get out of their home safely? Are their windows obstructed? Are their exits obstructed? You know, so yesterday I was just talking to a family member where the mother-in-law is going to have back surgery, and her environment is so cluttered, it's so dangerous, that she won't be able to get, first of all, her wheelchair through, and she isn't even able to get, well, they have a two-story, so they're going to have to make the family room a family room for her. And, it, you know, is she, and this home is really, she can't even move in the home, so her being able to get in, gurney's getting in. You know, I have clients where, you know, they're in a situation where a gurney can't even get in the door. You know, so a good chance of dying in that environment. Also, again, physical, and depending on age, physicality, is it set up for us? Is it set up for handicap? Is it set up for whatever? So that those are important to think of with physical benefits to being organized.
I don't know if you have anything to add to all that.
So my two favorite things about the physical effects of decluttering is, and y'all said it, financial in several ways. You can get control of your bill paying, your mail doesn't build up, and once in a while we find checks when we're going through stuff. I had a client who had been throwing all of her mail in bags, and she'd gotten married the year before, and we found some wedding checks in her stuff that she didn't know she had. And also, it's easier to clean. The fewer things you have, the less you have to dust.
That's worth it just right there. Okay, so what are some of the emotional benefits of decluttering? Randy, you want to start with that?
Sure. Okay. So clutter is noise. When we are, so it's virtual noise. So if one has emotional challenges, let's just talk about anxiety or depression, being in a cluttered environment, it's just like they can't even, think straight. So, there's a lot of emotion that's kicked up from clutter. And, that's one of the things, again, that I see all the time is that it's not only can I not find my keys, to get out the door, and it's, I can't even leave, but I don't even know where anything is. So just being able to find my stuff, and being able to feel good. The other thing, an important part of that is feeling good about myself, So if I look around and the clutter is an external component of my internal chaos, I'm not going to feel really well, about that. So there's a lot of really, important emotional factors that play into clutter.
I've got some of the same things. There's more calm, less stress when you're not seeing everything that needs to be done. Clears your mind. Also, people aren't embarrassed for people to come into their home. If it's not, that's a an emotional thing. That's like no one can come because I'm so embarrassed by how everything looks. And that's what same thing that Randy was saying is that the stuff is talking to you all the time, even though it's been there for a while. You don't realize it's that constant nagging at you. Mm-hmm. Oh, look at me! I've got to do this, got to do that, and those are the emotional things that you don't realize all the time. And the same thing about being easier to think. I mean, if I've got stuff on the table, I cannot think. I have to get it all sorted and put it where I can at least start with one thing at a time. And again, we all think differently, and that's okay to have very creative people who are very outgoing, but at some point you still have to have the physical things in your life organized in some sense where you can at least find it.
Something you said reminded me, if y'all have ever heard the term chaos, C-H-A-O-S, can't have anyone over syndrome. I don't know who came up with that first, but anyway, I
don't like that.
But also family conflict, sometimes, really family comes into all of these. Decluttering can help with some of the emotional dynamics with family members too.
Great. Let's see.
Where can people take things that are not considered trash? And I have a list. Did you see the list?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, great. So I'm gonna hand this out, and it's basically just a resource list for disposal of household items. I do not have enough copies though, however. So
I'll go much more.
Oh, she's doing great here. Thank you. I'll pass it out on this side first, and then we'll get some more. But what's interesting is it's by topic. So for example, art supplies, where can you take art supplies? And then it gives you a list of where you can get art supplies. I happen to take some of the items off of the NAPO website.
Yeah, that's great. We have a huge
website
resource.
Website is awesome, so you can go there and get more information there. Mm-hmm. And then just added some more based on experiences that I've had. So.
And also, that's napoaustin.com, napoaustin.com. Yeah. And that you'll find lots of resources there.
Also, organizers are listed there too, so you can learn about the different organizers.
Yeah, yeah.
And Randy, didn't you win a big award this year? What was your award?
Yeah. Last year and this year, one of the top professional organizers in Austin through expertise.com, and then that was these past 2 years, and then also number one professional organizer in Austin by Sparefoot Storage. So.
Excellent. And Carol also has some awards. Yes.
I was on the expertise list too.
That's awesome. Yeah. Rock stars up here. That's why we're learning so much. So,
if I can make a comment on this,
sure.
The one that she's passing around, one of the my favorite places since they first started is called Austin Creative Reuse. They are phenomenal. They are the best. I would go there first before I take anything. Austin Creative Reuse, and it's on the list.
And the list is coming right now. So.
The one thing that I like so much is that not only they're taking supplies and reusing them, but also teaching craft art classes, but they also help teachers, and I love this part of it. So they will package papers and pens and things, and then the teachers need it, you know, back to school, they can get free supplies or very, very, very minimal cost for the supplies.
Yes.
So they're a wonderful resource, and they will be moving this summer too to a new location. Right now they're in the Linkdale Lincoln Village, the Link, L-I-N-C, and now they will be moving later some to a bigger place where they can take more supplies, but
great.
They are wonderful.
Do you know where they're moving?
No, they haven't said yet either.
Oh, also another really great one that we didn't put down there was Reusable Reads, which is part of Austin Public Library.
Say that again?
Reusable Reads.
Reusable reads.
Recycled
reads. You know what? I have those both in my brain, and I always say reusable because my brain
so
is
they take,
recycled.
They take books?
Yeah, they'll take books.
What was the name?
Recycled reads.
Recycled. Read a book.
Is it recyclable or recycled?
Recycled.
Yeah. Reads.
West Bank Library.
Oh, yes.
Oh,
yes.
Fabulous. So what we're hearing up here is that the library here will take books, and maybe they won't put them into the library, but they'll sell them to help pay for the library. So that's
recycled
awesome.
Recycled reads does that too.
Yeah, excellent.
Oh, and I just want to mention another one on here, Age of Central Texas.
Oh, yeah.
If everybody's familiar with them. Mm-hmm. There's a location on 38th Street, kind of near Central Market. There's one up in Round Rock, and they do lending of medical mobility equipment. So. Mm-hmm. Crutches and wheelchairs and shower chairs and all that stuff. They provide daycare for senior citizens and respite for caregivers, classes. Oh, they're just such a wonderful organization.
So you can, if you have items that you want to donate, such as a wheelchair or a walker or crutches, you know how you need those things temporarily? If you give them to Age, they lend them out. So people don't have to buy them, which is really nice. So.
And isn't this true that they also repair them? So if you have something that's a little, you know, wonky, you know, they'll repair them and then they'll use
yes.
them.
Great. Yeah. Okay. Oh, yes. Do we have a question?
Age also provides a third-party evaluation of assisted living places.
Oh,
so
great.
You get a spreadsheet and you aren't talking to a salesman.
Great.
You're talking to a City of Austin employee.
Great. So what she's saying is Age has information about assisted living communities that you can get from them as opposed to going directly to the assisted living communities. And it's better coming from them because they're a third party impartial person. Yeah. Okay, great. So any other questions? Well, we're going to have question and answer at the very end, but sure.
Do any of the places that take books, know if they get them to prisons? Ever since Michael Moore's story, I thought, what a wonderful place to have going to.
So the question is there some kind of nonprofit or group that would be able to take books and put them into prisons? Don't know,
don't
but
know.
Google that. I would just Google it.
Yeah. Or even the library, maybe.
I think the Assistant League of Austin donates some of their books to the prison system.
Excellent.
Austin Assistant League is in partnership with many other organizations in Austin.
Oh, that's great.
That's great. And they also have a resale.
A lot of people here know about their shopping there. It's wonderful.
Right. So the Assistance League has a resale store. So if you donate items there, then the money goes towards other nonprofits.
It's sort of a I know one of the ladies that works there, and they think it's the highest end resale shop in Austin.
Awesome.
You know, they have Chico's and all different.
So, and they're located on
like 45th Street and Burnett Road.
45th and Burnett. So go there and shop and go there and donate. Yes. Somebody else had a question? Yes, ma'am.
In terms of books for prisons, Unitarian Universalist Church has a program called Inside Books.
Okay.
And they take books to prisons.
I'm not sure that's on here.
Is it?
Inside
Books. Oh, great. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Also, our community, our West Bank Library, the books that we don't, that we can't take into our collection, the ones that we donate go to prisons, jails, homeless, like shelters for women and families, hospitals. They go to a lot of them.
Great.
Other libraries.
We have to put that on our resource.
Yes,
you know,
definitely.
Some of these other ones on our resource info. That's great.
Okay, here's a good one. What suggestions do you have for someone that can't decide whether to keep, donate, or sell sentimental belongings? We could spend a half hour on this topic alone. Take it away.
So I think they're probably going to say something similar, but it's hard to sell your stuff, as many of you have probably discovered. People will pay pennies on the dollar for what you think your furniture or art is worth. I actually don't recommend doing garage sales because it's a lot of work. It's a lot of work. For not much payoff. So I always encourage people to donate. And there's tons of good charities like we were all talking about just now. But the other thing that I suggest people to do with sentimental things, and whether it's something that Aunt Matilda gave you or artwork that your grandchild did, is take pictures. Because the memory isn't the thing. The memory is the looking at the thing and remembering the person attached to it. So if somebody is comfortable with digital photos, I recommend taking pictures of that sentimental stuff. I've done that with my stuff. Some of my older clothes that I wore long ago, I can look at a picture of them and remember, you know, where I worked and who my friends were and where what did and all this fun stuff and everything, but I don't have to have that blog.
We're probably going to say a lot of the same things. But my first thing would say, just ask family members if they want anything first. If you're that, you feel like it's going to a good home kind of thing. You know, that sometimes we are very sentimental about things, so we will have to know where it's going. Again, taking photos of, so you don't have to have all the items taking up the space. A very good friend of mine made a shadow box, and they're wonderful because you can hang them on the wall, but it can have some of the keepsakes with the picture, and you get all of those things related to it in one place and hangs on the wall. But then it's not in a box somewhere, it's out where you can see it, but it's not taking up a lot of space. The other thing I would say about the whole thing about buying and selling things or donating, some of the best ways is just to go on, you know, eBay or look up anything real quick, or Craigslist, and just see what things are selling or what they're going for. And if it's not worth your time, then you know, like, okay, these items, you know, I'm not gonna deal with, but this is important, so yes, I'll try to sell it. So that whole thing of get the piece of paper, make your list, just start going down with everything that you're, you know, trying to decide on.
And also taking pictures and sending them to family to ask, you know, because a lot of times my clients will say, you know, I really would like to give this to so-and-so, but I'm hanging on to it because I want them to see it. Okay, they could see it in 2 seconds. So, you know, so what makes it sentimental? You know, know, so I'll ask myself, what makes it a sentimental thing? Do I have space to store it? And I mean, that's important about everything that we have, is do I have the space? Do I, you know, for me, my mom had given me a hat box, and I love to, and I have letters from my grandparents in it, and my mom, and friends, and, you know, so I have it in a place where every time I look at that hat box, it's a hat box of love, you know, so it just makes me really feel good. And, you know, for me, it's sentimental, and, you know, it doesn't take up that much space. But even if something takes up space, do we have the space? So if you do, show it, you know? So.
I had heard one idea about china cups once, and a woman had a big collection of china cups, and she was moving to a much smaller place. And so what she did was took photos of all the china cups, kept four, took photos of everything else, and then did a poster with all the cups and put it on the wall. Didn't that sound beautiful?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you just, you know, you take the photo, but you make it into some kind of art that you get to, you know, see it and get excited about. So I thought that was a great idea.
That's cool.
It does.
It's really cool.
Okay, what recommendations do we have for parents that want to pass down their family heirlooms to their adult children? I'm trying to do that right now, too. It's frustrating. Yeah. Carol, give me some ideas.
Yeah. Well, I was
going to
have them go
for you. Well, I have my articles about this. So
okay.
I'm ready for this one because, you know, I know we've all been reading it. It's the thing of the younger generation, they don't want the style of the older furniture and china and every silverware and all of that, or they don't have space for it, and they really, really love experiences, not the things. So we think, oh, but you're going to love them. I've been saving it all these years. Well, you know, maybe you do have children who do want that, and that's great. So that's the same thing earlier. Talk to them. Do it now. Talk to your kids. Talk to, or other relatives, nieces, nephews, whoever you think would be interested in it, talk to them now, and you're deciding what's going to happen to these things, not someone else. So that was the first thing, is that definitely you ask them, you know, what they would like. So talk to them, and you believe them if they say no. No guilt. No guilting them. It's like, oh, but I've saved this for so long, and you need it, you'll love it. No. Okay. And then also another thing I realized on this is that things have a lifespan. It's like not everything has to last forever just because you bought it. And a friend of mine, that was a long time ago, it's so funny, this phrase I've always remembered, she said, you bought the pickles, you didn't buy the pickle jar. So you don't have to keep everything that you've ever bought because, well, it's practical, I might use it someday, and it's, you know. So that's, you know, everybody's done it. So it's sort of like, all right, you try to think of those things. And let me see what else. Oh, this was the other thing I thought that was so cool. Art. This is the motivation. Is that if you can sell some things and you've already gotten that on the rent, then you take that money and you take your children out to dinner or on a trip, depending on how much stuff you sell. And so having the experience with them, they're enjoying your time, and those things are somewhere else and someone else is enjoying it. And that was the other thing, is that someone else may need it. If I'm holding on to this, that's like hoarding. It's like I'm holding on to this, and someone else in some charity somewhere could really, really use this. They need a bed, or they need a dresser. And so I'm trying to think of motivational things that will get us, you know, inspired to do this.
All right, stop. You're not giving us any time.
All right.
She reads an article or two, and it's like she's up for it.
Tell the title of those articles, because those are really good articles.
This is Aging Parents with Lots of Stuff and Children Who Don't Want It. That's from the New York Times. And then this one is Memo to Parents, Your Dumb Kids Don't Want Your Stuff.
Tears.
She wrote the book Downsizing the Family Home, and her name is Marnie Jameson, Jamison. Downsizing the Family Home.
That's cool. I mean, you can go on. I mean, I don't have to say anything about it, but you know, also what Christina said about getting every penny you can out of something, you know, and so not wanting to let go or having your children keep it is this thinking of, okay, I bought it for $20. I'm going to sell it for $18. But you've worn it for 18 years. You know, so it's like, you know, getting every penny. And also, you know, as Christine said, because she said a lot, is, you know, having, this is outside of what she said, is having not only having your children take a look at these things, but also I've had this experience where the thinking of, I've given a gift, not me, but a gift has been given. What if somebody comes over and it's not displayed? Well, once you give a gift, that person gets to own that gift, right? And nobody gets to tell that person what to do with that gift. So that's boundary issues, you know? And so that person is keeping this stuff because they feel an obligation to it. And so that's like, you know, family heirlooms is that obligation to have to pass it down. But we grew up in that kind of thinking where, you know, I grew up with, you know, keeping stuff. And I do have stuff that's been passed down because I like it, you know, and it's my husband too. And it just so happened that they worked together. But if I didn't want it, you know, thankfully, I didn't have a parent that was driving me crazy about it. But man, there's a lot of people that's the thinking. And it's okay, but you know, here you go, that's that.
One thing, and it's not a question because I read ahead, is what if you're trying to be fair to your children in giving them items? That's not one of the questions.
Yeah,
so,
that's really good.
There's a software package called Fair Split. And basically, it's like an online bidding for the items in the household. And so,
that's so cool.
Yeah. And so like each kid gets $10,000, let's say, for example. And you've gone through and taken pictures of the item and assigned a value to it. And so then they can go through and they can purchase what they want. Now, some people say you rotate through, you start with the eldest, you know, and you just let them rotate through, but they buy the stuff. So that's called Fair Split. What else have you seen? Have you had to deal with that very much with the adult children wanting to distribute the items fairly?
No, but that's a great idea.
That's a really great idea.
Yeah. So, trying to think of
You know, also appraisals, you know, having an appraisal, you know, appraisal company come in and appraising, and then really, you know, having an understanding of what things might cost, you know, again, it's contingent upon when that person passes, but having an idea, like the fair, of, and then saying, okay, you might get X amount of dollars based on how much this is worth. But then when the person passes, that's the thing also, is having an appraisal, you know, an estate sale, where then it can be divvied up, and that's part of the will. So, and that's also, you know, the same kind of situation.
And there's a really good book, it's called Grandmother's Yellow Pie Plate, something along those lines.
That sounds
and
cool.
That's another, it's funny what people will fight over, sadly. And this fight was over the yellow pie plate. Everybody wanted the yellow pie plate, you know, because that was what grandmother made the pies in. So the book is really good if you're having some kind of conflict with how to distribute items. And actually, I try to encourage my clients to distribute items while they're alive.
Yeah,
so they can
yeah,
enjoy so the granddaughter wearing the ruby necklace,
yeah, totally.
You know, or the cross or whatever. Because there's so much more, to me, there's so much more joy in that. But I was surprised. We sold the baby grand piano. It was my father-in-law's piano. We didn't have room for it. So we were going to sell the piano, and both of my children were so upset because they both thought they were going to get it. And I was so really thankful we sold the piano because, you know, at our death, they would be at each other's throats because they both had these wonderful memories of grandpa at the piano. So you don't know what people, you know, what their heart really wants. So
yeah, like we talked earlier about talk to your kids now.
Talk now. Yeah, get it all out there. Okay.
I have nothing to add.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Sure.
No.
Just
accept
it.
Great. Do it now before you're gone.
Yes. So what's the difference between someone that's a collector and someone with a hoarding disorder?
Okay, so let me just say, based on the definition of a hoarding disorder, okay? So the definition is the acquisition of and failure to discard a large number of possessions that appear useless or of a limited value. Second one is can't use rooms as they're intended. And the third one is significant distress or impairment in functioning caused by the hoarding. So one of the questions, one of the number of questions that I'll ask when somebody calls me, and it's the person that has a hoarding disorder, is are you able to use your rooms as they're intended? Can you sleep in your bed? Can you use your bathroom or bathrooms? Does your plumbing function, right? Can you cook in your kitchen? And contingent upon those answers, plus one of the biggest questions is, have you been diagnosed as a hoarder? Because people will call themselves different things. Okay, so we call ourselves pack rat, we call, you know, but the bottom line is the diagnosis is hoarding disorder. And so there are really critical questions to ask based on that. So, okay, so a person that's a collector. So, again, you can live in your home and it's not causing distress. You are displaying and you're proud of. That doesn't mean that a person with a hoarding disorder isn't proud of, but, you know, you have it displayed and you're proud of your whatever it is. You know, and it is, you know, again, the most important thing is it's not causing distress. So anybody else have anything to
add? The only thing I was thinking of a collector, someone who buys and sells the items. It's right. It's not right. Just keeping everything.
Yeah,
I
for
just
sure.
Kind of think
sure.
That is the definition. But.
Yes, ma'am.
Any idea of how to get rid of some collections, like from a past marriage, I have button-up collections.
Okay.
We have antiques that I don't really want to, my kids don't want them.
How about we answer?
And they're worth individually just a little bit on eBay, but as a whole, somebody might want them. Mm-hmm.
You mean I went to the end? Okay, so we're going to hold questions to the end,
okay.
Says the organizer.
Okay.
So where were we? We were doing the hoarding. Where? How do you get the diagnosis? Who do you go to? What kind
psychiatrist.
Of
psychiatrist?
A psychiatrist. Okay. Is there medication for it?
Well, that's a really good question. No. So there's a lot of different factors when a person is diagnosed with a hoarding disorder. And it could be a lot of different things, like a person having a brain injury, a person having, let's say, a couple of coexisting conditions from a traumatic event or events in their life. Chemical, definitely, anxiety, depression, you know, so organic. Genetic, so there's a genetic component to hoarding disorders. So a number of, like, cognitive behavioral therapy is helpful. Also, certain medications in conjunction with each other, it can be helpful. Like what I was saying before about depression or anxiety, there is no cure. You know, like there is no cure for depression. There is no cure, you know, for traumatic brain injury. But there is management. So that's the hopeful part of it is the management. You know, and so that's where I come in conjunction with working collaboratively with psychiatrists and therapists and social workers and, you know, my colleagues too, again, because we do different things, that what they bring to the table also is really helpful, so.
Okay, what can happen to someone that lets clutter get to the point of a hoarding situation?
Going to be her
yeah.
Again.
Can you guys say something? No, I'm not really.
Well,
I don't
deal with hoarding. I never.
I can say something.
Go
okay.
For it.
Safety. That's the big thing. I've had several clients who are hoarders, and they can't manage to walk around their house safely. They're tripping over things, or they have to move things to get someplace, and they're older, and they're bending, they're moving heavy books,
yeah.
And to me, it's just a huge safety.
I think also that I haven't heard anybody mention is the impact it has on other people.
Oh, gosh,
yes.
Yeah. Oh,
yes.
Got it.
I still have PTSD from
that. Yeah. Are you a child?
In-law. My
okay.
Husband's mother.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my goodness.
Hoarder,
yeah.
And it had bad, bad effects on him. And he also is kind of a pack-ratty person, but he's aware of it, so he guards against it. So it is, I think it is somewhat inherited,
totally.
But the angst, I mean, I kind of get a little hostile. Because, and to me, when you were going through the definition of it, it's not only your physical safety, but the safety of others. Do you have people in the house? Do they have allergies?
Yes.
Are you asking even adult children to negotiate, like chaos, to negotiate around your chaos and not be able to come over and all these things? And I felt like, you know, it was kind of a subset, but it was also, it was used as a weapon to a certain degree. You're not helping me clean up. And then when you went to clean up, you couldn't throw anything out. So
you're not doing it right.
Right.
Yeah, you're not, whatever, because it's a mental health issue. It's not an organizing issue.
Right.
You know,
it's, go on and on.
Yeah, but see, the thing is, like what you just said in regards to children of hoarders, the impact is tremendous. And we're not only talking about the children, and like you just said about the grandchildren and the, you know, so not only can there be that genetic component. So I was doing a study a number of years ago about children of hoarders, and I spoke to, I think it was like 20 children of hoarders to see, because we were doing some studies with one of my other associations, because they were changing the one of the diagnostic groups that came out, so that the looking at what were the impacts of that, you know, of the situation, like you're saying, the ramifications were huge. I just had this conversation yesterday with a, you know, the hardest thing is that for somebody like your husband, and who, whether it's his siblings or whatever, that not only living there but as adults wanting to help their parents. The parents aren't the ones that are motivated to make the change. So if the person that has a hoarding disorder isn't motivated to make a change, and they're, you know, they don't even want to think about it because they haven't been properly diagnosed or whatever, the family, you know, splits apart, you know, or the family just doesn't have anything to do with them after their children, not to mention the health and safety risks. That's sometimes the least of the problem, because the kids do grow up with all kinds of, you know, health issues because of how the environment that they were raised in. But their mental state of mind, the children, is devastating. Yeah. So,
shall we move on? We're going to switch gears now. Okay. So when you walk into your home each day, mail is piled up all over the place. What are some tips for handling mail?
Thank you.
Well, I could talk about this all day.
We want to hear.
Really, everybody has trouble with paper, virtually everybody. It's very common. And there's multiple ways to deal with it. But one of the couple of things I want to talk about is one thing that I recommend to my clients is to turn off some of their mail that doesn't need to come in. Like, for instance, credit card solicitations. You really don't want to get credit card solicitations. And there's ways to turn that off. There's a website, I should have put it on the resources.
Yeah. Tell us more.
There's a website called optoutprescreen.com. Optoutprescreen.
Pre-P-R-E.
Mm-hmm. It's like all one word for the website.
You know, I've done something like that before, and it comes back again.
Well, it used to be, I think, that you could turn it off for 5 years, and now you turn it off permanently. So you might try it again.
One more time.
Yeah. And so it's a little scary for people, because you actually have to give them your Social Security number.
Wow.
But it's, yeah.
Is that a scam?
No, it's not. It's not
okay.
A scam.
Okay.
This website is run by the credit reporting companies.
Okay.
So they already have.
But
they have to make sure they
already sold their information.
Yeah.
Equifax has already given their information away.
Straight to the trash.
They have to know that it's really you. So trust me when I say it's okay. But you have to give them all your information, and it really will, after a while, it'll completely turn off, because you don't want identity thieves being able to get your credit card solicitation, pretend to be you, open credit in your name. There's lots of ways to avoid identity theft, but that's one of my favorite ones. You can also turn off catalogs with catalogchoice.com. That's a free one. And you can search for the catalog you're getting, or they have this humongous list that you can go through, and you can tell them to stop sending me those catalogs. And just those two things can really reduce a lot of unwanted mail.
Hey, I have a ton of stuff too. So that was my first thing.
I have more, but I'm gonna let you.
Yeah, yeah. She's being so kind to the old lady today. No, the thing is, you want to stop it before it gets to your house. But in the meantime, the first thing we usually always say is just have one place for the mail. It doesn't go on the kitchen counter, on the dining room table, or in the living room. One place. Just get a box if you have to. Anything to stop and have it all in one location. And then, the thing about reducing the mail for sure, if you can get on auto pay for bills on everything, so you're not getting the statements, you're not getting all of that information that you really do not need. And also having a recycled bin for your junk mail, so if you haven't gotten off of those things yet, having it nearby. I think the thing is, what I found with many clients is that when the mail would come in, they would stop and they'd look at something, and it's like, oh, wait, I've got to do that. So they would sit that one down. They go to the next thing and look at it, and then I don't know where this goes. So taking, way too much time looking at each piece of the mail. So what I usually tell people is doing a quick sort. Go through real quickly all of the junk mail, toss it real quickly. Letters or statements, or just sort those. Don't look at what it is, but just sort it in piles. Okay, then go through those that you have to do, immediately. Usually we get distracted. You start doing that, and someone or your child says something to you, and you have to stop and go do that. So it's trying to stay on task. But again, the main thing is having it in one place to start with. Then I had a bunch more. The other thing was to have, for family members, have bins or pockets. So this one is like my absolute favorite, because it's a really small place. It holds a lot of information. So anyway, it holds hanging files, and then you can put folders inside of that. But the main thing is that tell everybody, vertical is always better. If you've got it spread out here, it takes up so much more room. You can get all of your mail in one of these easily. And when it's spread out this way, you have to go through. It takes much more time, again, to sort through every pile to find what you're looking for. When it's this way, it's kind of teaching you to file, and that's a time-saving and also a space-saving thing. So,
how would you use each of those folders? So the blue one would be,
Okay, that could be for bills or things that you still get the paper copy of that you need to deal with, or maybe it's a bill from a landscaper or and different situations like that. Then it could be things that I need to file this away for my taxes, but I don't have time to go do it right now, so I'm going to stick it in this folder, and then that will go into my permanent file. So it's kind of a temporary filing cabinet for you. So, and then the other thing would be events or things that you have to go to. I would say have your calendar with you while you're doing the mail. So when something comes in, oh, I've got an invitation to this, you immediately go to your calendar and you can see, well, I've got something else on that day, so I can't go to that. So you can either reply if you need to, or if not, just, again, that gets thrown away. So things to go to that you maybe need information on that invitation as far as the address or things like that. So, yeah, there's a lot more.
I have something to add.
Okay, all right, go ahead.
Are you done?
Yeah, that's it. Okay. No, I have more, but that's okay. Go ahead.
Well, I just want to add a tip about this. So sometimes people start thinking that they have to make a ton of different categories. Like each one has to be a very, very, very specific thing. And it's better to have broad categories. And the reason is because you don't want to get confused later. So say, for instance, if you had a file for your kids, and you had a file called medical for doctor's bills and stuff. Well, you get a doctor's bill for your kid, and which file, and you're gonna start getting tangled up and, oh my gosh, it's not perfect, and yeah. So broad categories. I do things like to call people I have to call, to pay, to do, just really broad, just because when you're in a hurry, what you want is a home for that piece of paper. And just make it as simple as possible to put it in its home.
Yep, for sure.
So this is active, it's not static. So we file to retrieve, we don't file to store. So what that means is, for this being an action file, these things have to come out of here. So you could set, like Christina said, or Carol said, set a time, you know, that this stuff's gonna go bye-bye. So it's either gonna go away, because we don't need it anymore, because when we have, and I think we're gonna talk about, oh, Carol is the master of record retention guides, right? And Carol, she worked for the IRS in her past. So because this stuff is active, if we don't need it, so I might have one that says input to computer. Once it's input, it's gone, right? And so I have another one called upcoming events. So anytime, oops, for me, it's like upcoming events, I'm gonna have that on my phone, but I also might wanna have a little backup paperwork. Maybe I have a little, whatever it is, right? I might have some tickets that I don't have on my phone. But understand that a lot of things that we do now are PDFs, right? They're online and we can just go online, so we don't have to keep things. But this is really a great thing, and also the really cool thing about this is it's portable, right? So you can take this anywhere, and you're sitting in front of the TV, you're doing your thing. So
great for doing taxes.
Yeah, it's really good for taxes.
Then you go in the
living room with it.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah,
you drop your stuff in it.
Something that's not on here is photos.
Mm-hmm.
Any ideas on photos?
We have colleagues who specialize in photo organizing.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they love. That's what they're good at. That is not what I'm good at.
I can
label all your photos on your computer and put them in folders and get them all organized that way. But these people will take all your old scrapbooks and they'll scan each page
and
make
really
it all digital.
Fabulous. So if they go to the NAPO site, would somebody list that that's one of their specialties?
Yes.
Yeah,
we have all specialties.
No wonder it's not on our list then.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's just stick to our questions. Okay, what about some record retention guidelines, Carol?
Oh, hi, why did you do that to me?
Yeah. I have a list.
What'd you bring here?
Well, this is, again, anything we say is, you talk to your financial advisor first, but these are just general times.
Yes.
So
good disclaimer.
Yeah. Always do that.
And that's one reason I hesitate to say things like this, because your accountant or your CPA or your bookkeeper may have different opinions, and you should listen to them, because I'm not a financial expert.
So it's that thing of the 3 to 7 years, three years for financial, for taxes, but 7 years for business. That's the general.
Yeah. And for things to keep forever, birth certificates, marriage certificates, death certificates, home buying. I suppose you don't have to keep them forever once you've sold the house, but I do.
It's fun to look back at.
Yeah.
See, you paid $29,000 for a house in
1980.
Where do you recommend that you, I'm asking where you should store those papers, those really like the birth certificate and those kinds of things. Where do you recommend?
Well, check with your accountant and your financial person. I have mine in a file cabinet in my home. Some people do fire safe boxes. Some fire safe boxes are better than others.
Or safety deposit boxes.
Or safety deposit boxes, yeah.
And there's a difference between fireproof and fire resistant. So fireproof is a better thing than fire resistant. So,
But you know, I have a client who has kept all of her insurance policies for the past 10 years, and they're expired. She renews it every year. She doesn't need the old ones. But she wants to keep them, and it's not my job to say, no, you have to get rid of it. None of us go into people's houses and say, you have to do such, you know.
None of us.
You don't?
We don't.
I thought you might.
We don't. So I don't think she needs those insurance policies that are expired, but she does, and she's, you know, it's her house, so.
Okay, this is the fun question. Share an interesting situation you've experienced in your client work. So.
This is funny. It's been mine earlier about the money. The one thing is that I have found money for every client I have ever had. It will be cash, it will be checks, it can be stocks, bonds, all kinds of things. So that for me is over the years, I'm like, gosh, I don't think I've ever had a client that I didn't find money for.
So they could pay for your services,
yes,
because you found money for it.
Yeah, that's great. I mean, I wish over the 17 years that I've done that, because it's gazillions of dollars and everything, like birth certificates, jewelry, I know every single thing you could imagine. So I've had a lot, as three of us and organizers have had a lot of interesting experiences. Not that long ago, a really sad experience was this gal. She was in her early 70s. She had fallen down in her driveway. Her home really needed to be demolished. It was in such bad condition. You could barely walk in it, and it was piled. I mean, walking in it was piled and very dangerous. And I was called by her neighbor, and I mean, the town was ready to tear the house down. So she had crawled to somewhere to contact somebody because she had fallen down and nobody was around. She had, this was the one of the things that really stood out, was she had a refrigerator on the driveway. And so that was the refrigerator she was using, was on her driveway.
Wow.
So that was just recently, so I'm not gonna go back to it.
Yeah.
That was sad.
What you got?
I guess my interesting stories are about how some things that it doesn't even occur to me that my client might not know, I find out that they don't know. Two examples. One, I was working in somebody's garage, and he had one of those big ladders, and he had some shelves way up high, so he's getting up on the ladder and putting stuff up on these high shelves, and there's stuff all scattered around the base of the ladder to where he could trip on all of that stuff. And I watched him for a minute, and I was just like, why? Yeah, let's not do that. Let's move everything away. It's like a basic safety thing that sometimes people just don't think about, because we do this all the time and our clients don't. You know, another example, paper gets really heavy. You know, one little piece of paper is very light, but the reason file cabinets are so heavy duty is because an accumulation of paper gets super heavy, and sometimes people don't know, and they'll take one of those huge Rubbermaid plastic bins and start putting all their paper in there, and that's not going to work because it's going to be heavy as an elephant. You're not going to be able to move it. So paper should be stored in smaller file boxes or things like that. Stuff like that I have to remember that, oh, they don't know this. I need to tell them this because they just don't know.
Something I forgot to say earlier. There's this National Shred Day that's coming up.
Yeah,
Arma.
Yeah.
And that's in April, and it's
April 28th
at the ACC campus.
Yeah.
So that would be when you want to take all of that stuff, and they will take your boxes of papers and then I think.
Where's ACC?
What?
It's the one
at
Holland
Mall.
On Holland Mall.
That's it. That's
the airport. Yeah.
I think,
and you said April 28th.
Hopefully,
we'll find out.
It's on Saturday. It might be either Saturday. Is it 20?
It is. It's the.
So they normally do it right after tax time, which is great because you do your taxes and you have all this extra paper. Do they limit on how much you can take?
I looked on their site. I couldn't find anything like that.
No, they just
think. What's that?
Until they're in capacity.
Yes. Yes. It's best to go early.
It starts at 8 o'clock.
So do you pay them?
No, they don't pay. So it's from 8 o'clock in the morning till 1:30 in the
And as far as I know, you don't have to take the staples out of your.
No, don't take the staples out.
You don't have to worry about that.
Talking about going through houses and finding things that were unexpected, I don't know, but at this age in my life, I have jewelry that has come from, you know, other relatives and gifts and rings I had as a child. When the cost of gold is up, I took jewelry, you know, one little earring, a rope for chains, a bracelet that was hand-tooled and gold. Turned out to be, it was from the Middle East, it was 24 karat gold. I got a chunk of money.
Cool.
So, Russell Gorman jewelry.
Oh, cool.
The other thing is, I mean, I have rings that boyfriends gave me, you know, just an accumulation that I'll never wear. They'll take the stone out, return the stone to you, and you give you the money for the gold. They don't want the gold, they just want the gold.
Okay, so Russell Gorman.
Gorman.
You can take your gold, and she's what she's saying is, you know, if you have one earring and don't have the other one, it's just sitting in your jewelry box, why not take it and go recycle it and get some money for it? Yeah, broken chain.
You can dump it all down and make a piece of jewelry.
That's great.
And then somebody had a question here, did she?
Nope.
How many years did you say to keep on tax returns?
Well, it's they say if it's just individual, 3 years, but if it's for business, 7 years. That's just the standard.
So anything beyond that, you can take it.
Sure. Right, unless there's something specifically unusual about that tax return, okay. then you want to keep it longer. So
doesn't the IRS have your tax returns?
We hope so.
They actually, when we had an issue one time, this is the IRS, not what we're going to state. We called them up and they were asking us questions and we said, well, it's on the return. And she said, no, we ditch the return the minute you get it, we take the check, and if we need to ask you a question, you have to provide another copy of it.
And you have to provide the backup too.
Yes, I would keep all of your tax returns forever.
Yeah.
Yes, a copy of it. You don't have to have all the backup, except the form itself, everything that you sent in, right?
Well, the other thing that the IRS will say that you could take as humorous or not, depending on your point of view, is if it's a fraudulent return, you have to keep it forever.
Good to note. So there was somebody who was seated
the collections.
There. Oh, it was you? Okay. Yeah. So your question was, you have items, collections, how do you find out the value of it?
Well, so, or where do you sell it? I don't want it, but I don't want to donate it. It's not a donatable thing.
There are experts who will sell that for you, who specialize in doing sales on eBay and things like that. I don't know, maybe somebody
can reverse. We have a colleague who does that.
Okay, so they have a colleague.
But
what you can do is you can go, there's like a back office in eBay, and you can find out what those items sold for previously.
Yeah.
And so that's really fun. Also, Everything But the House is another website, and you can go there and you can see what items sold for. So if you're thinking, this picture, I'm going to get $150, well, you can go and see what it actually sold for. I'm sorry, you had
a question. There's also a place I just noticed down on Bee Cave, down where Trader Joe's is and the car place. It's a state, they do a state sale items, so I was thinking that I would take some.
They'll take a cut, but they'll do all the work.
I'm sure your colleague will too.
Yeah,
they're going to take a percentage. So I have estate sale liquidators who will come in and do estate sales on the property, and they typically will take 40 to 60%. But if you're trying to just sell onesie, twosie kinds of things, and you want to know what the value is, I would go into eBay or Everything But the House and find out the value, and then do it yourself or, hire someone.
Everything But the House is a website?
It is.
It's not part of eBay or?
No. Everything But the House is a fairly new way of selling.
Who are some of these experts?
What's that?
Who are some of these colleague experts?
Go to your website again? Or?
Well, she doesn't have it on our.
But you know what?
I was going to say the name. Her name is Marilee Aboud, Abboud, and she's on the NAFO list, and she does sell things through eBay. Yeah.
She doesn't say on her description that that's what she does, but she does.
Say that name again.
It's Merillee.
Merilee.
Abboud.
So she's on the NAFO list.
Put that.
We're working on her. We're and so marketing.
When so you go, this so is our.
Brave, still appraise stuff?
No, she doesn't do appraisals.
No, she helps you sell it, package it, send it,
Oh, okay.
All of that, the whole thing.
She'll do the photography and the description of the item and the listing, and she leads with the buyers, so you don't have to do all that.
They're not coming to your house. They normally take it off-site and do all that kind of stuff. So this is the question-answer period, and we've got about 15 minutes. So, yes, ma'am.
Thank you. First of all, it was real fun. Everybody's so experienced and enthused about your work. But I really came not to hear what is hoarding and, you know, what does it make you feel like. And I want to know specifically, how long do you keep those files in that folder? Because I've done that, and it's too full now. Well, I can't keep up with it in a week. And if I had time during the week to do it, I would have done it.
Okay.
So I just wonder, are there guidelines on specifically turning stuff?
Well, why is there so much in the first place would be my first question. What
part of it is there's no auto investment paper, bill pay, and again, there's no agreement in the house that that should be done. So the papers that come in daily are stacks. It all goes on a, everything you've said is, agree, those are good ideas. It's just not working for us. We're doing them.
Okay, so
I still have more than I can manage.
And there's no way to get on auto pay at all. That's just a, you have.
The bills I pay are on auto pay.
Right, right.
Only the house.
So that's what I'm saying. That's not negotiable.
Yes. Not negotiable.
I learned right. So well like that.
Yeah, I mean, it's just at our age, there's just an old way of doing things and not
yes.
letting go of the the paperwork that's in the file cabinets, plural now.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah.
So
very organized as far as how to put it somewhere, but I just don't think we need to keep it.
Well, okay. So again, what are you asking?
So, okay, how often do you empty that file?
So it's
to do, call,
up to you.
It's time management.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. So you're saying within a week, this would just be totally full.
At least a week less.
So I guess my question is, first of all, I could keep all of my bills in just one of these.
Yeah.
So that's why I'm saying normally you don't have that many of the bills. If there's any way to consolidate it at all, I mean, everything has to keep separate? Or I'm trying to come up with some quick answers. And
I
think
appreciate
I need
it.
To know
what,
more
what
of
I'm
the situation.
Hearing you say is there's another person that's not
I mean, I'm married, and my husband wants the paperwork, and we have a lot of investment paperwork that comes in. All the
prospectus. Okay, now I'm understanding.
And,
it's...
to three now, so... Oh, but I'm just saying that I don't know what to do with it in the interim. I can file very well.
Oh, yeah. You're keeping way too much stuff.
My financial guy says not to keep all those perspectives, that you don't need them.
Yeah, it's a matter of conversation. I never even look at them.
No. Or could your financial advisor tell your husband, you know, maybe get someone else involved and say, by the way.
Sometimes they'll listen to an organizer.
And there's a lot of things that come in like this for today's event that one of us is not sure, does the other one want to see it? So it's all checked, thankfully.
You know what, and so there's another, I don't know how helpful this is going to be, but there could be another category, is to speak to your husband and throw stuff in that so that you can have a family meeting. Can you meet on a regular basis to be able to go over the paperwork? Because sometimes it's not fair to you to have to manage stuff that's, it doesn't make sense to manage it. It
and
exists
also,
somewhere else.
You're asking him, does he ever go and look at any of this stuff?
Yeah, I mean, that's a big question. Because
if
he's
not,
then you just go, you have an agreement.
Yeah.
So it's also kind of, I'm hearing kind of a time management thing, because it sounded like your question was, how often, right?
I'm just curious about other people's lives. I know what mine is.
Everybody's life is different.
I'm just curious. I mean, do you empty that weekly, monthly?
Daily.
It depends.
Weekly, monthly. It's,
It depends, but to keep it manageable, which is what it sounds like you want to do, to me it's all about making an appointment. It's just like making an appointment with a doctor, you know? And whether that's once a week or once every 2 weeks or whatever, it's like, okay, I have to do this for 15 minutes, and then I'll go.
But it's not so much about that. It's about another person that's not playing ball. So what was your question?
Well, I'm moving my folks from a house they've lived in for 60 years. Mm-hmm. It's awesome.
so the distance involved. And so you've had kids grow up, grandkids grow up, all that fit in. And my dad has to take care of my mom, so she's not of help. So I've been trying to give them guidelines on how to move, or what to take. And I was wondering if y'all had any ideas on that. My idea was to, I don't know much about the state shelter or anything like that, but I was thinking they could go through and we could pack up what they want to take and then leave everything behind.
I can answer this question.
Definitely.
Okay, so being a realtor, and that's what we specialize in, is the move management. Typically what we'll do is figure out where they're moving to, and we'll do a diagram of where they're moving to, and then we'll measure out their furniture and help them place their furniture. So they might have three sofas. Well, you're only gonna be able to take one sofa and one chair. And so then you start that conversation about which sofa would you like and which chair would you like. And then that's exactly what you do, is you move them, get them out of that environment. You can have a liquidator come in and they can just give you, I'm gonna give you $500 for everything in the house, but they'll clean it for you. So you don't have to go through and you don't have to box up everything. So you can get a liquidator if it's not valuable. Estate sale people, what city are you in?
They're in Alvin, we're in Austin. Alvin is southeast of Houston.
Okay, so it could be that you would just have an estate sale person come. They need to make enough money or they're not gonna do it, but they do not want you to box up anything. So if you, that's why you take what you want, you leave all the kitchen items where they can see it, where they are, because that's where they're gonna sell them.
Right.
They're gonna sell them in the kitchen, in that cupboard. So you think you're helping the estate sale person by taking things off hangers and putting things in, you're not. Leave everything in the linen closet except for three sheets, a pillow, and a bedspread. It's perfect. And get them out of the chaos. Don't have them be a part of it, because if they're not feeling well, it's really hard to see things go away or be donated or whatever. So that's my recommendation.
That's great.
You guys want to add anything?
No, that was great.
Oh, yes.
Sorry.
I do. There's this thing that we were told, if you have it, like my directive to know life's support, that I'm about to die, just leave me alone.
Yes.
And then someone said to keep it in your car, glove box.
Okay.
Now, would you agree with that?
No.
So what we're talking about right now is those kind of documents that if you're in an accident, you know, your directive as to how you want your care to be taken care of. And she's saying that she heard that you're supposed to put it in your glove box.
That's
in
interesting.
Your car.
So, you can keep it wherever you want. You can make as many copies as you want. You keep it in your glove box. You keep it in wherever. Give it to your family member. Everybody. Keep it in
I've heard that if the hospital, it's going to put you on life support whether you want to be or not if they don't have it.
Right.
Yeah.
And they're not going to know to look in the glove compartment anyway either. They're going to just be getting you out of the car as quickly as possible.
Yeah, nobody would.
So, I mean, you could have it, but I still don't see how they're going to get that information.
Yeah, they wouldn't.
The best thing in an emergency is to tell all
everybody,
your family members.
Yeah.
Tell your doctor. Tell all the different doctors you might have. And your siblings.
Yeah.
And
you might want to put something on the back of your license.
That's a really good idea.
Put something on the back of your driver's license that says, look in my glove compartment or look in my purse.
She said put it on the back of your insurance card.
They're not going to put you in the hospital without your insurance card, so put it on.
That's a good idea, too.
You guys learned something. Did you
have a question?
Someone
said tattoo. It's like,
I
don't believe that because you might change your mind.
My parents are gone. Aunts and uncles are gone. I have a few distant cousins that I never see. I have four or five good-sized boxes of my mother's pictures, my granddad's pictures, my grandmother. Some of these folks I know, some of them I don't have one earthly clue. How do I get rid of the guilt of putting them in the shredder? Nobody cares.
Wait a minute. There's ancestry.com, and a lot of people from other families might want those pictures. That's the only thing I might say, because I just started doing that.
I hadn't thought about that.
And what you also need to do is whatever county they were in or the city they were from, those libraries and archives and genealogical societies will just take photos, identify from that area. You don't have to know the names of the people.
Oh,
they will take that as part of their collection.
That's great.
Love to have it. That's a huge place for all of you who have questions about photographs. You can have them put in a historical place where they are meaningful for researchers that are from your family.
Oh, I love that.
It could be the XYZ collection from Montgomery County. And that's how they would research them.
That's great.
That's great. Well,
my guilt is going away.
Yeah, really.
Did you have a question?
Talking
about the county. The county historical society. Yes. County historical society. So whatever county those photos were taken in, contact that historical society. Man, I'd box that up in a box, all my pictures, and send them off tomorrow. I feel so great.
That is yes.
I grew up in a really small town, too, and they have a little historical society.
Yes.
My mother donated my first wedding dress, which was in the 60s, to them, and they have it on display.
Oh, man, that's great.
A lot of stuff from that small town. That's not important to me anymore,
yeah.
And donated to them. And
oh, that's just great.
So, you know, like you, if you have some things like that.
Yes. I love that. That's a story of the town. It's the people.
You mentioned ancestry.com. Tell me more about what you're...
They were saying you would be putting your information, if you want to do that, or the genealogical information, you would take the pictures and that could go online, and then other people who are searching for your information...
Family. Yeah.
Would get that, but again, it's distant relatives you don't even know you have. That's but then you may not want to do that either. So
you have to scan it then.
Right.
Then
so you would scan
okay.
it in, and yeah. then it would go.
You
yeah.
should.
Yes. Question
There's,
in the back.
Something advertised on radio is called Legacy, and they'll send you a big box where you don't ask me how they do it. I haven't done it yet, but I think about 12 million people have. They put all your pictures, your photos, your DVs, anything that you have of your family, recordings, anything in this big box, or for me it had to be a huge box. And then you send it to them, and then 2 weeks later they send it back to you either on a thumb drive or on CDs or whatever. And don't ask me how they put it all together, but I'm interested enough to find out. And I know for the last several months it's like 40% off, but people have been real
interesting.
That's so cool.
And it's called Legacy?
Legacy.
That is cool.
I've done it.
$75.
Oh,
you did it?
Who did it?
Yeah.
Okay.
You have to put you buy a certain amount.
Okay.
And they set, you know, you have to decide what you want. Like I had recordings of my kids on
VCR.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That I wanted.
Yes.
And so you have to be real specific.
It's good.
Okay. How is it expensive?
Yeah.
I can't remember now what
yeah.
it was. It was like about a year and a half
yeah.
ago.
Yeah.
And my son-in-law pitched in, and she had something like that
yeah.
he wanted
yeah.
to. But
right.
Yeah, I think I might have been
like $100 or something.
Okay, so like it's over, but I guess this would be, yeah.
But you get all the other stuff back. And
yeah.
it's like, okay, now what do I do?
Oh, they send the stuff back.
Yes.
That guilt again.
Yeah.
No, they send the stuff back. You have it on the thumb drive.
Yeah,
they send the stuff back. You give it to your historical society.
That's right.
That's
yeah.
awesome.
That's a great idea.
Any other questions about decluttering or any other comments? We do have an evaluation which we would love for you to fill out. It will help us for future seminars. So if you would fill this out and leave it in the back, we would
Thanks,
greatly
ma'am.
Appreciate it. But we do have a couple minutes
we could take
if you have some more questions.
I think we're a great team. I don't think I know what
we're Any more questions?
Well, I do have another question. Which I know they're going to say just pitch them.
We have a question in the back. What do your services cost?
We're not going to talk about that. You could call us up individually because we don't want to do
some of us have our rates on our website.
But would you come out and look and then assess? Or
sometimes
you
just over the phone.
Verbally.
Yeah.
Usually over the phone.
Okay.
Please fill out the eval. Thank you. I hope you all learned something. And
we have one more question.
Oh, we did. I'm so sorry.
I know what she's going to say, pitch them, but
I have a particular magazine that I subscribe to that I love, and I do go back. Now, the issues that I totally know I'll never look at again, I do finish. But if that collection can get, so I put them in tubs in the garage. I mean,
You know what I suggest? Look at the table of contents. See which one you're interested in. Pull that out. You could put it in a folder. You could get rid of the rest of it.
The pages or whatever.
Yeah, just get rid of the rest of it. If you're not interested, chuck it.
I have that same thing with knitting magazines.
Yeah.
So I just went on eBay and bought a hand scanner because my husband has tried to get me to just stay at the copy, you know, printer and scan the pages and put them into like OneDrive or something like that. I'm like going, I'm not a sand here, a copier. And you get bent pages, you know, yeah. So I went and bought a hand scanner so you could just roll it down the page.
Oh, great.
And then download it to your computer.
Yeah, that's great. Scanning is great. Scanning is a great thing.
Yeah.
You know, they have and they have other smaller ones, SnapScan. There's a bunch of different ones that, you know,
yeah, I looked at some of them because some of them, unfortunately, you don't have to tear the page out and feed it through.
Yeah.
Right. So you don't want to rip up your magazine because, you know, then you could, you know, if you've got a real collection of them, it might be somebody else's treasure and they want to buy them off.
No. Don't listen to that. It's nobody else's treasure. It's online. No treasures. No. Make believe she didn't say that. Nobody's buying magazines.
We have another tip.
I was just going to give y'all one little tip that has saved me so much aggravation. I don't know about you, but when I buy medication sometimes, there's an expiration date on there, but you have to squint and hold it just right in the light to be able to see it. So I take that expiration date and I just write it on the front.
Oh.
Because 6 months from now, I'm not going to remember. And then I can just look and go, okay, that's still good. I don't have to toss it out yet.
You can do that with canned food, too. Sharpies are like my favorite organizing tools. You know, binder clips, Sharpies, you know, favorite cheap and cheerful Ziploc bags, you know, my favorite organizing tools.
Can I have one quick other thing?
Sure.
I'm an only child, and I have an only child, and I have some historic family things that are so important, but that she just has to want it, right? Like my daddy's World War II, you know, badges and medals and all of that that were in a box, put in a trunk, nobody ever saw it. I put those things in a shadow box.
Yeah.
They are in my entryway. Every time they come in the house, everybody looks at these things. Oh, this is cool stuff from World War II. The grandsons are seeing it every time they come. And I'll be darned, she will never want to throw that away. It's already in a shadow box. People are relating to it because they see it. It's not stuck away, out of the way.
And
some of the very most precious things that you really want, and they're small enough to put in a shadow box, I'd say do that. Nobody will have the nerve to pitch it.
We have another question.
I just have one more thing to say. I had saved from my parents all of the newspapers for Kennedy's assassination.
Oh, yeah.
Space thing, you know, stacks of stuff. I finally took that plus a lot of books to Half Price Books, thinking these things were going to be worth something. They threw it all in the garbage. They took out one thing that had something about LBJ on, because this is Texas, and one set of French tapes. I got exactly $5.36 for all those things I've carried around.
They don't want them anymore. But you know, like what you're talking about with all those, you know, Kennedy and the spacewalk and all those things that are really important is, you know, just like you were saying with the shadow box, these are things that can be framed or, you know, something creative.
But then it
no, for people that are, you know, for people that are really interested, one page, you know, or the cover or something, or it could be scanned or it could be the photograph of it, whatever. But whoever next, they can decide what they're going to do with it. Especially if it's small, if, you know.
Well, the small things, it's a great idea.
But digitally,
I had a whole newspaper.
I love it. What you just said, because, you know, respectfully, the gal said, you know that they're worth it. Magazines are worth it. Heck no. They're only worth, they're worth it to the person, but they're not worth it to other people.
Yeah, I thought my grandchildren would use it, but now we have computers. Why would they want
to? Offer it to your local library and let them decide.
They didn't want to.
One more.
I have one comment and question. I find myself
incapable of throwing away anything that might possibly be useful to someone.
Yes.
And very often, I'm able to clean this out or clean that out, or, you know, even to the point of clean rags. And then I say, well, what the hell do I do with these?
But there are so many donation places that will use that. In fact,
but how do I find out which donation places will use them?
Go to
that list that we gave.
That list.
Yeah.
We have even more on the Naples site. There is a textile recycling place that will take those.
Yeah,
they're
a
all
lot of,
listed.
There's a lot of places.
I scanned the list, but
yes.
I didn't.
But Naples Austin has it also, if it's not on this list, if we miss some.
But the other thing is, sometimes I just take stuff to Goodwill.
Oh, I do
that too. And let them decide.
That's my favorite place. I can't throw it away, but...
Let them decide.
Yes. And they do have people who can use it because there are circumstances.
Yeah, and even cloth, even with fabric and stuff, they do. They'll send that to places that they do use that fabric. Now, if it's little stuff, you know, that you're thinking, you know, somebody else can use it, all right, who? Mm-hmm. So you don't want to give, you know, even with all these wonderful donation places, they are fantastic. But also think about, do you have the time to do that? Because that's important. Are you making it a full-time job? If you have the time, fantastic. It's got to be what works for you. You know.
We've got one more question.
I have an old, outdated computer that I'm hesitant to take anywhere because it has personal information.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I go
Best Buy will strip it, and then they'll recycle it.
You can trust.
You could trust them. They are great. I mean,
also,
I've been,
Goodwill has their
Goodwill
computer.
Also, that's right. They have a whole division.
But I don't know if they clean it off.
No,
yeah,
but
see,
Best Buy does.
But
Best
the
Buy
other
does.
Thing is, if you can get to the hard drive or you know someone who can take it out, mm-hmm. if you have smashed
not,
it and drilled a hole
a,
in
not
it.
On a app, not on an Apple yes. computer. There is no hard drive to.
I would try the Goodwill. It's listed on that list to see if they, and maybe you could just stand there while they do it. But otherwise, go to Best Buy.
Best
that
Buy
is
will do
really
it.
Critical. That's a problem.
They don't even charge you.
Oh, they
just
don't?
Give it, no.
Oh,
you just
shoot.
Give it to them.
Done.
They will clean your hard drive. They're not, you know, they're doing it. They're a corporation that's not trying to.
And we have that comment.
I want to tell Randy a funny story. If you were in the middle, you were talking about maybe you got something from somebody and you didn't know whether to display it or not. Well, my mother's taste was not the same as my aunt's taste. And one Christmas, my aunt gave her a Toreador, right? And my mother was like, just colonial, right? Like, so at the end of Christmas, she put it up on the top of her buffet, her china cabinet up there. The next Christmas, my aunt gave her the bull. And she said, I just thought it would go with. And the Toreador wasn't there. My mother got rid of it.
Oh.
So.
But see, if she put it up there, she said, oh, it, we bumped the thing and it fell over.
Yeah,
the
road. She said, what are you going to do? You have to deal with getting stuff from people you really don't.
That's the thing, like elephants or something.
Yes.
Oh, my elephants.
So
yeah.
Well, like, I just remember that story.
Well,
that's
let's
cute.
Give a big hand to our organizers.